Hello, my name's Jonathan Wyner. Welcome to Are You Listening? Before I dive into today's subject, which is going to be, are the robots winning? No, it's going to be about how can we make use of AI and machine learning in the context of our mastering practice. Please, at the end of this video, go to iZotope.com and check out all of the different learning opportunities that are there. We've got blogs, videos, Pro Audio Essentials. You can even learn by interacting with the products that we make. So on the topic of AI, you know, this is a little bit of a clickbaity subject. There are some general kind of morality plays connected with the notion of artificial intelligence and machine learning and robots taking our jobs. And while there's some reality to the fact that artificial intelligence can result in automation, and automation can have impact on our lives in a variety of ways, in the context of creative work, I think there's still a very clear demarcation between the notion of automation and the kinds of things that we can measure that are actions that take place as a result of the measurements versus creative decisions. And understanding the context of our creative work for making creative decisions is something that's still very much in the purview. There are a couple of different ways of thinking about AI. One is in an automated fashion. There are automated online mastering services, for instance. When I last counted them, there were 18. And they offer a service where you can upload a track and get it back in a way that it has been changed, it has been mastered to match a specification that was determined by the designer of the system. That may or may not have value to you as an artist, but it's certainly not a bespoke version of mastering, right? The machine isn't sitting down and saying, you know, the verse and the chorus aren't matching up quite right, or, you know, this song isn't feeling quite right. It's generally speaking going to make level adjustments and tonal adjustments, adjustments to the tonal balance. But before we dismiss it, one of the things I want to encourage you to do in the name of informing you about the tools that are out there and what insights you can derive is every so often, test one of these systems. Go ahead, upload a track, get it back, see what it did, see if you can get some insight into what might be possible. You can almost think of it as kind of a preset for your work. If every time you tested an automated system and every time a track came back brighter, you could step back and say, I wonder if, in general, my work could be a little bit brighter. So it's kind of a very general way of saying, staying informed, using these systems as opportunities to learn and gain insights and understand some of the intelligence that has been built into the systems can be valuable to us. There's the automated version of these tools, and then there are the tools that are designed to be assistive. The tools that use data analysis, neural networks, and machine learning to provide insights to us. And those are the things that are particularly interesting and frankly, particularly exciting to me. We've spent some time in other videos talking about tonal balance control. Now, tonal balance control is an environment where you can see the distillation of spectral distribution, bass versus mid-range versus treble over time, that represents kind of the best practices. That's artificial intelligence. It is analyzing so much data and gaining insights in a way that we can't as individuals gain. We also have tools that are driven by AI, such as the Master Assistant in Ozone. If you hit play on a track and run the Master Assistant, this is something that's designed to give you a starting point, to give you some insights, kind of like what I was saying before about getting insights from automated systems. But the difference is that once you run a track through this system, you're then given a preset that shows what the recommendation would be to alter your track so it conforms to kind of a best practice model. But then you can take it from there and you can accept or not accept the results. You can decide what component of the results you're interested in accepting, or you can just undo it and move on and do your own version. So after the assistant is done working, you see there's a limiter setting, there's a little bit of tonal balance change that's recommended, and some dynamic EQ that's designed to keep the limiter from working harder than it needs to sort of optimize the signal. But now it's time to start mastering, given the insights and the context that's been set for your work. So these are ways that we can work with these AI-driven tools or machine learning-driven tools. But there's another implementation, and that is in the arena of source separation. So for those that are not familiar with it, source separation basically is a fancy way of saying unmixing. You've got a mixed signal, and the machine can not only find, say, the voice in a song, but it can allow you to adjust that component to a pretty high degree of fidelity, up or down, without having to go back into the mix. If your answer or response to this sort of tech is to say, well, isn't it better to do a better job of it in the mix? The answer is yes. Make the mix as good as you can. But here's where source separation and machine learning actually gives us capabilities as mastering engineers that we never had before. And it actually is kind of exciting when you think about it. So in Ozone, I'm going to open the master rebalance tool, and you can see that there are three instrument groups that are indicated here: vocal, bass, and drums. Those are the easiest to separate because they have such specific attributes. It's easier to pull those out for a neural network than it is to differentiate between a Stratocaster and a Telecaster, you know, that might both be happening in a mix. And we can adjust the gain of an element up or down. Now, where would this be helpful? Where would this be interesting? Well, here's one of the challenges that we have as mastering engineers. When we use compressors, like we sometimes do, one of the things that we trade off is the idea of density and glue and smoothing the level and getting more RMS level. We're trading that off against the clarity of the transients, because that's kind of the nature of what compressors do. You squash a little bit, and then the transients lose a little bit of their clarity. And you may already be able to see where I'm heading with this. So if I set up a compressor, and let's say for some reason I want a fast attack time and a slow release time, which means I'm going to be stepping on the transients, and then the release is going to hold. So the overall, the track is going to get a little bit smoother. I can put the master rebalance tool just in front of that and turn up the drums by just a half a dB. It's just like taking the mix stem and pushing it up a little bit. Now, could you have done this in mixing? Yes, but this is now a mastering decision. I've decided that in mastering, a little compression is a good thing, but rather than have to struggle with this trade-off that I've always had to struggle with when I start compressing something in mastering, I now have the ability to have my cake and eat it too, have my compressor and have my drums too, and the liveliness of the track. And so I can push it up. So I'm no longer having to deal with the same kinds of compromises, and I could only have done this because I have a tool based on this technology. Here's another example of the same basic idea. One of the easiest ways to get clarity when you're working in mastering is to just take a little energy out of the mudroom, right? The area between 150 and 250 hertz, where you get some separation between the bottom and the warm part of the vocal and the warm part of the snare drum. But there's something else that usually happens when we clarify a master that way, and that is we lose a little intelligibility in the bass. I could go to my bass stem, as it were, in the master rebalance. This time I might put it after the equalizer and turn the bass up a third of a dB just to get back the intelligibility of the bass instrument. So now I've clarified the mix, I've kept the balance between the instruments where I want it, and I don't have to grapple with compromises in the same way that I used to. I'll give you a couple of examples where tools that are based on this technology really kind of fall down. And I think it illustrates this sort of notion of the difference between the technical capabilities that they give us and the ability to curate decisions and be creative. So one example that illustrates the point that the machine may not always have the right answer or the best answer might be like a Billie Eilish record. If you take a look at the tonal balance, if you take a look at the the shape, the tone, the level. The machine will tell you it's out of bounds. It's just not conforming to what is correct, what has been done before. Well, there's the statement right there that leads us to say, we're not always looking to do what's been done before. We're looking to take chances, express artistic ideas. Nobody can say that Billie Eilish's record wasn't successful. There's an artistic vision that was portrayed there that could only really have been arrived at through creative thinking. In the same way, during one of the experiments that I'd mentioned, where I uploaded a track to one of the automated mastering systems, I was working on a track that had a very quiet intro, and then a full band kicked in, and it had a ton of impact, and that's kind of what the band wanted. You know, if you were to take a record like Chinese Democracy by Guns N' Roses, a ton of dynamic range between sections and songs. If you fed something like that into an automated mastering system, it would seek to level the track from beginning to end, and in doing so, remove some of the impact, the dynamic contrast that was built into the art and to the expression that was in the music. What gets me especially interested in machine learning is what we can learn. I've been committed my entire career to education around audio production. I started teaching it almost as soon as I started doing the work, because I found that, you know, teaching is a great way to learn something. It's a great way to find out if you really understand something and to sort of break down what you're doing. It's also a way of giving back. That idea, that ethos, is something that I have tried to bring as much as possible in conversations with and in projects here at iZotope when thinking about implementing machine learning. In what ways can we learn from the tools that we make? In what ways can we learn from the insights that the kind of data mining or signal analysis that we can do provides? This really is truly what is especially exciting to me about it. It's also interesting to think about ways in which it could stimulate creativity. There's something called style transfer, where you can take one kind of signal shape and imprint it on another. Imagine taking a dubstep record and imparting the signature of dubstep on top of a string quartet. We've not done this before, but it's interesting. It's a new idea. It's a new possibility. It might be horrible, but it might be worth trying, and it might be stimulating. And in the right context, curated by a person, it could produce something that we've never seen or heard before. In this way, the machine learning-informed tools give us new capabilities. This will continue to happen. You know, it happened when MIDI came out. We had new capabilities. Before MIDI, we weren't able to connect machines together the way that we can now. A lot of music production that's being done now wouldn't be possible without it. I think when we look back at machine learning that's starting to be developed, or the tools that are informed by machine learning that are starting to be developed today, we're going to see a whole new class of tools that enable us to do things that we could never do before. So I'm excited about it. But more than anything, I think it's incumbent upon us to understand what the tools are, what their capabilities are, and decide when and if to use them and how they can make our work better. So I hope you find that stimulating. Experiment with these tools, and thanks for watching.